First up is approval of the May minutes, which you all got? Yes. Thank you, Noral, for getting them to us. Any changes, addendums, edits?
I move to approve.
Second.
Well, who's taking notes today? Jordan, you're up for today.
Oh, I am?
Yeah, but you didn't bring anything.
I'm totally unprepared, I'm sorry.
That's okay, I'll do it tonight.
I'll be happy to try next time.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
I really apologize.
That's okay, I should have put it in the agenda here, I'm sorry. There is no public comment. So the next agenda item is about the policy that the Northampton Housing Authority has this summer about air conditioners for its residents and its buildings. There were a couple of newspaper articles that Lori sent for background. I was approached by someone who lives in one of the Housing Authority buildings, who did not want to go on record with the complaint, so we don't have an official complaint, but who shared concerns about some of their neighbors with frail health or with very young children were concerned about when the temperature hits in summer, the worst of the summer heat. Question is whether we consider this a, does this rise to a human rights question? And would we like to have more information from the Housing Authority and ask them about what drove this decision and how they are planning to check in with their residents who are most vulnerable when the temperature reaches?
So was the concern that was brought to you from the building that the Gazette article, because there's actually different policies based on which housing place you're in.
Yeah, it was a different building when it was in the Gazette article.
So is the concern about the availability of air conditioning or what kind or?
Residents that have window-based air conditioning units are not allowed to use them this year.
I would think that clearly rises to the level of what we would be concerned with.
I agree.
So the article said that in the other housing plans, they do not, they actually have sleeves in place, so if you have air conditioners, they can do that. Also, according to the article, they're trying to make air conditioning available with credits. So I think the what I guess what I'm, they have not outlawed air conditioners. What they've said is you may not have window-based air conditioners. So there's a series of reasons, stated reasons why that's the case. It's actually workman's comp and safety issues. I think the problem here is the timing, maybe how they did this as opposed to whether it's a correct, whether it's another kind of problem. So what I can't tell, the only information I have is what's in the Gazette article. And whether that is, if that really tells the story or not.
Well, I think that it would be, we as a commission would ask them to please provide us some further explanation. Would that be the right, you know, just so that we can get clear what the exact challenges and the reasoning are?
So what I'm not clear is, I know there's one building with sleeves, but there are other buildings that where these same window air conditioners are no longer allowed for the same reason. And if you're on the ground floor where it's not going to fall down and drop on anyone's head.
also whether people can install themselves or do they ask people from the Housing Commission to place them. And I think that's the workman's comp issue, if that it was involved with the install. So if you're an individual who can't afford an air conditioner, what happens? And is this only an issue for people who've purchased an air conditioner that they now cannot install or have access to?
It's a good question. Certainly there are tenants who can't afford an air conditioner and they just don't have one, so it's just hot in the house. But there is a very active network of people passing on their air conditioners to one another. So that is one way that tenants, they get handed down air conditioners from folks who are either leaving the buildings or families or friends. So.
Am I right in thinking you can get air conditioners that sort of stand up inside?
The office is offering those.
For $200?
Yes.
Very expensive.
Yeah.
With a $100 credit.
And they're not as effective. They're much more limited range. It's like a space heater, but it's a space cooler.
It's been a while since I've had one, but how much are though? I think the last time I bought a window unit about 4 or 5 years ago, it was like $150 or something. Wasn't that, I think I got it at Sears or something. I don't think it was like $300 or $400.
Yeah.
But I understand the situation too. $100 could be food.
Right, and a number of families the staff assistance has been reduced. Right. Heating assistance was reduced last winter, so if there was discretionary income, there's not.
That's what I was going to say. I have a few clients in the area that one of them, for example, she has two newborns and it's her, and she doesn't have any source of income. She's only getting $30 a month for food. Food stamps, so for her, something like this, $25, because they said you can pay it in $25 increments, doesn't seem like a lot to someone else, but for her family, it's the difference between being able to eat for the week and not being able to eat, so that's why.
Out of the question.
Sorry?
Out of the question.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I would love to get some information from them specifically as to their reasoning as to why they can't or why they won't, and not just base our thoughts off the article.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think as a Human Rights Commission, it clearly is something I think we would ask about. I mean, you're talking about people. I mean, I think about these poor people on Sunday when the temperature is going to be 100. I mean, can't live in that.
Hopefully the city will open a cooling center again.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah, but still, even that, you know, to tromp all the kids and everything, like to just be home.
Yeah. What struck me in the article that I read was that our health inspector and our fire department in the city both seem to say we don't actually think there's a problem in having the window-based air conditioning units. So, and again, this may be just how it was reported in the newspaper, but if the primary reason is they might fall out of windows on people, our public safety folks aren't particularly worried about that. I did try to look up some statistics on how many people are injured by falling air conditioners in the United States, and I could find zero.
I mean, that's purely an installation issue. You know, having them put in properly and left there, I've never seen it a real problem. But putting them in, that's clearly can be a challenge for somebody on the third floor. You have to, you need more than one person, you gotta know what to do. But once they're in, I don't see it falling out of real issue, but I don't know, maybe I'm wrong.
I mean, they do fall sometimes when you're installing them, I have no doubt.
Right.
But it's done carefully. There's no record at all of it.
Well, can we do that then? Can we? I think that would be worthwhile.
So what's the question?
Yes. I was about to ask what questions would we like more information about. My questions are about what, to clarify what drove their decision to ask about their process for tracking our most vulnerable residents during the heat waves and how they will evaluate the decision after the summer heating season.
Makes sense to me.
I guess I'm going to have one other question. Is there, can there be any interim plans considering we're in the middle of, you know, in the very middle of the summer?
I would frame it as a health issue of an issue of people being able to survive.
So
I mean, time and time again, we see this people of dying from heat exhaustion or heat stroke.
So what if we, I mean, I think the issue of finding understanding, I think almost everyone who are in public housing are at-risk populations. So it's like, it's like there aren't safe people and unsafe people, it's everyone. But if the city says every housing place has an air conditioned area where if people don't have air conditioning and they need to be able to go, that's available. That's one of the things the article in the newspaper said.
That there's a public space in that
within,
housing,
yeah.
Yeah, not in every housing.
Well, so that's the question. And for the one that was being written about. See, what I'm concerned about is that there's actually different policies for different places.
Mm-hmm.
And the article is really about the building where they weren't allowed to place them. So if you were in a two-story part of public housing, I have a feeling you could do whatever you wanted.
Mm-hmm.
It's the variance. That's why. So I agree with saying people with health issues are at risk, whereas people who have health-related problems or respiratory diseases are at higher risk in heat and humidity. And since everyone has a right to a health and safe place to live, when there's a need for air conditioning, that might be part of what's necessary. What are the policies for having access to air conditioned spaces or safe air spaces in public housing? Does that sound okay? Where I take care of highly vulnerable people in Springfield. Very few people have air conditioners. And it's also, so it's more like getting access to a safe place. I think the But I'm a little, I'm concerned about our writing something that makes it sound like air conditioning is a human right.
Okay, my frustration, if it was a whole city of Northampton type of rule, that'd be one thing, but when it feels that it's targeting people of lower socioeconomic status, it's frustrating to think that they can't, even if there's air conditioned spaces in their building, why can't they be at home like everybody else, watching TV, enjoying, like not being miserable and hot? Why do they have to take all of their kids and their whole family to this one area to sit in to be able to be cool? They should be able to be cool just like everyone else, and it should be their choice whether or not they want an air conditioner in their building. And I know it's been an issue in the past too, with Northampton, like that housing department in general, the ACs, they're always trying to get rid of them by a certain time of the year, and you can't have them for longer, even if it stays hotter longer. It seems in the past, it was formed more of an eyesore issue. I don't want to like make assumptions, you know, because the article says something different, but it seems like they figured out I don't want to say things, but it seems like it was figured out to be worded in a way that comes across as, oh, it's safety, we have your safety in mind, when in the past it's always been an eyesore issue and more of like, we just don't like you keeping the AC units in there for so long because it just doesn't look good, and they are in control of a lot of other things that you can have outside your house, inside your house, things like that. So that's where it comes from me, where it's coming, feels like it's attacking people who are socioeconomic status and dictating how they can live their lives. It gets to a point where it just doesn't feel fair.
I mean, we're not talking about the city or somebody buying them air conditioners. I mean, my understanding is they're saying you're not allowed to have one. And all I'm saying is I just think we need specific clarification on their reasoning for denying these residents to be able to have one, as opposed to everybody deserves one. I understand that. But to sit there and say you are not allowed to, okay, why? Give me the reasoning, because I do think it's a health hazard not to have one and something like that, you know.
I personally don't care for air conditioning. We have an air conditioner, so this is an interesting topic for me to think about advocating around, but I do think that a number of our residents are public housing or more vulnerable to heat and the associated health distresses than I am, for sure. So I think it's the equity of access that.
Yeah, that seems to be more of them being able to have the choice of whether or not they want to.
A question. If I want to put it in a minute. Have things tightened up since the new director changes have happened? If any changes have happened since the new director?
But things tightening up, it seems to me.
Well, maybe that's not it.
Yeah, I'm not sure I don't know how to characterize it, but I know that a lot of new policies have been.
It sounds like some of them good and some of them more sweet.
So I think, let me try and capture what I've heard. That I will contact the chair of the Northampton Housing Authority, which is an appointed board like ours is, and express to them that we have some concerns about, or some questions about, the policy around restricting window-based air conditioners. Concerns stem from vulnerable populations that live in our public housing, people with health issues and respiratory problems who are at higher risk of illness during high heat. The fact that everyone deserves a healthy and safe place to live. I will ask them to help us understand what their policies were for driving this decision. How will they be accountable to those residents with heat-related health issues. Is there another?
No, the whole issue of equity.
Equity of access to.
And I wonder too, if some people have purchased air conditioners, are they going to, I don't know, is there any kind of program set in place to, if someone just put $500, you know, to, I don't know how much air conditioners are actually.
Yeah.
So maybe I'm just being like, inflectuating it much more, but whatever amount of money that they just put towards an air conditioner, maybe now they can't afford to pay for whatever other units they're providing, are they doing some kind of option, trade-in option, or a way to rectify that? Because like the article said, it definitely would have been better for people to have, I don't know, this in January or something, so they could have prepared for it.
Okay, everyone comfortable with that?
It is strange that I would like to have more air conditioning, but the person I share my house with doesn't. But you know, when you have more resources, there are ways to work with it. Whereas if you have fewer choices, that
right.
There is so much happening in the world, and how do we choose what we will respond to, what we will lift up, what we'll put our energy towards? In the past couple of weeks, the zero tolerance family separation at the southern border has been high on everybody's agenda. And in the same time frame, the United States became the first nation in the world to voluntarily leave the Human Rights Council of the United Nations. What are we feeling called to do? How are we feeling called to respond?
I think we should definitely have some sort of a response to our withdrawal of the Human Rights Commission, because I think directly affects us. Mm-hmm. While I'm certainly incredibly concerned about the zero tolerance policy and all, I try and remind myself that this is the Northampton Human Rights Commission. And I think we have to focus our concerns on the city of Northampton. Not to turn a blind eye, I certainly don't mean it that way, but certainly our withdrawal from the Human Rights Commission definitely affects our Human Rights Commission, I would think. Now, if there is a situation of some refugees here who have been affected by the zero tolerance, then I think that we need to respond to that. But I just don't want to think we're butting off a little more than we can chew there.
There's so many shocking things in terms of human rights.
Absolutely. That's just my opinion. I mean, I certainly can be talked out of it.
When you say it like that, though, because I'm thinking, as you were both saying, that there's so much happening, so it feels overwhelming. Like, what are we going to address? So if we are able to focus on directly helping our community, it seems to be more, maybe we'll go longer, like a little bit goes a longer way instead of. But it makes it hard every time you hear anything. You just want to address all of it.
You know, the stuff at the border, even though it doesn't address, we're a long way from that border where that's happening, it still feels shocking and appalling. You know, should we let it go without saying this
kind of appalling
abuse of human rights? Happening in front of our eyes. But so many other things. The SNAP program being, so vastly reduced means so many things.
So because of the outcry a number of policies that have somewhat been reversed. So, according to the papers today, they are no longer separating children, and they're actually backing off on some of the stuff about zero tolerance, actually. So, outcry, I think, has led to some changes in policies. I am more concerned that sort of we're talking about those things, but SNAP is being dialed back. A lot of the other programs to take care of people are also being pulled apart.
Eviscerated.
And it's a little bit like what sits on the front pages of the major newspapers or this stuff, but then there's a lot of work going on. And one of the Supreme Court justices just decided to retire the second.
Kennedy
is going to step up. So, I think we should be doing something about pulling out of the Human Rights Commission because we're a Human Rights Commission. But I'd like to be efficacious about what's local rather than not. So, I'm more concerned about PBTA bus committee stuff being continued to do. What's happening with the SNAP program? Though actually, they've now gotten the local funding for the farmers markets, and some of that funding is coming back. This is what the person I share my house with and I talk about every night over dinner it's exhausting what's going on. And sort of making choice. So Janet was at General Assembly and she came back saying, there are too many places I should be going to get arrested. And it's like, how do you choose what to put both of your feet into? And I think we're going to be spending a few weeks ourselves trying to figure that out. I've been very proud of what we've done about talking to people with disability, talking more. That's sort of doable. It's important. It's something we do every day. So I've liked those themes we've started on. I'm scared to death about the idea of broadening the scope of what we do, because it's really hard. It's exhausting.
I'm not sure if this is included. I wasn't able to go to the meeting on Wednesday. I wondered if anyone else had a report from that.
Which meeting?
The meeting, I think it was Wednesday night, the meeting of last week, the second.
That is on the agenda.
It is. I wondered because it feels like it connects.
Yeah. Would you like to?
We could go there now.
Yeah.
It was a smaller meeting because we were competing with the debate that was going on at the middle school. A number of candidates were also speaking that evening.
Yes.
So it was probably about only 60 people compared to the 100, I think, who were there the very first time. The format was a little different. There were only three people who spoke sort of from a panel. The surprise member of the panel was, I'm forgetting his name, but he's the police officer who spends most of his time here in downtown Northampton. And he talked about what it's like for him to do what he does. Sort of how he tries to be supportive of what they're trying to do, because one of the reasons people are on the streets is around addiction-related issues and trying to help. The format was similar in that everybody broke up again and to six different groups, smaller groups, and each group told stories and then came back together. Again, at the end, it was, we're glad we're doing this talking. it's unfortunate that there aren't more younger people in the room. There was also participation from people from Cathedral on the night. It was the first time they were there. And one of the members of the panel was someone who had been homeless and then is now has a place to live, not on the streets, though a lot of his work is still so some things were better than that. It was in downtown, it was a somewhat more diverse panel. I think most of the discussion was how do you support people who live on the street, along with some concerns. What do you do when people who are on the street are unable to control their behavior and endanger others? Sort of problems that would happen.
Were there business people there?
Yes, but there was one member, it was not part of the larger panel discussion. But for instance, one of the members of the panels, I'm forgetting her name, but she runs 1,000 places at the store downtown.
10,000
places. Yeah. She's actually didn't announce it, but she's closing her store.
Yes. Oh, you're kidding.
Because?
Business. And hassles.
But the reason I ask is because I was approached by one of the businesses down here who was on this and just said that his business is down dramatically. So yes. He doesn't know how long he's going to be able to survive, and he felt like one of the main reasons was is because of the increase of people on the street. You know, and I just listened, obviously, but, you know, and he's, you know, his other challenge was finding people to hire.
So things got very complicated for me because one of the business leaders, I don't think Judy would mind if I talk to Judy Burrell, was not on the panel but talking, and she's having a really hard go of it. And she feels that what's just been decided about their minimum wage is gonna do her.
Yeah, that's what this person said too.
That they don't think they're gonna be able to. She feels that the only people, this is going to make a difficult situation much worse. And but none of those people were there talking about it, though that was also a discussion going on in the place. And I'll just mention that, I'm forgetting the name of the organization, there's a self-published commentary website, I think it's called Spring Street or Split Stream or something like that. They were actually leafleting about their discomfort with Dennis Bitter, who stepped back from being a leader of North Hampton Connects because he thought that would deflect the mission. But they were there leafleting saying he's really trying to get rid of panhandlers on the street. So he's really, they weren't there. But the leaflets were all over the place. So it was successful from having people being able to talk about their dreams. And another consistent thing was there ought to be a community center. So if people needed a place to get dry, to be able to take a shower, to go to the bathroom, and other things, it would be really good if there was such a place. And it would be useful if the city could move in that direction. And finding ways to treat people who live on the street well and thinking about how do you help people who have behavioral difficulties in terms of being at the forever veterinarian city. There's not yet a discussion about a next meeting, though there will probably be a co-sponsored meeting with the Sojourner Truth School for a meeting in September or October where it's going to be a discussion with the police about downtown issues. But there is this whole other issue that the business community feels like. Their sense is a lot of places who are here now will be here.
Yeah, I've heard that.
In another year or two.
I don't remember when it is that it has to go up to 50.
It's over the next 5 years, actually. It's a while.
Yeah, I had the person who told me that, and he said that was his biggest concern because he can't make a profit with the rent. I mean, he just sells very small, you know, small food store. And he just said, I can't pay that.
Thinking about why I'm for a higher minimum wage, but the impact that this may have is going to be very difficult.
Especially small local businesses.
Yeah, it's really horrible news about 10,000. Mm-hmm. I hadn't heard that.
And the Herald could have been.
She was actually active. She was one of the committee that met with the state legislature about talking about this stuff. And you know, she said everything went away. In one way, it's very progressive.
Yeah.
But one of the things was, is it 25? Certain things cut in if you have 25 employees.
Right.
Well, is it 25 full-time employees, or does it all add up? Is it 25 FTEs, or is it 25 people? And they thought it was going to be 25 FTEs. So that allows a lot of small businesses to not have to fly. They made it 25 employees. So it cuts in it cuts in a lot. She said if you're a place like hers, you have a zillion employees in order to staff the place. Paul and Elizabeth's have to have a zillion employees. It's sort of the impact of this. I felt terrible because I love downtown.
Right.
And I think a lot of what I love about downtown.
Exactly. It's my favorite thing.
And it's, ironically, that's going to go because I was trying to do something.
But looping back, I'm sure there will be another Northampton Connects meeting because there is a sense that people enjoy being able to have a place where they can talk. Though there is not that much varied opinion in the room. Though I think it was really interesting to hear from a police officer about their experiences and how they feel what they're trying to do. Do you have questions about that?
So I think that what I heard us talk about was a response to the United States withdrawing from the UN Human Rights Council. And I will draft a letter for the newspapers and run it by Lori. Is that comfortable for everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The bystander training. Lori was in touch with them, with the folks that do, I think it's Quabbin Mediation that did the bystander training, and asked about doing a training of trainers, which has a price tag. I think that I had a phone call with Lori before she went away, and I think what she said was that it's $2,000. So. Obviously, we don't have a budget.
Per person?
No, for a training of trainers.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, the question is, are we still interested in pursuing this?
who would we like to collaborate with? We could approach other Western Mass Human Rights Commissions and see if we would like to collaborate on it, see if each of us could find a little bit of discretionary money in our respective city budgets for this. We could also ask city councilors if they would like to collaborate and participate in it as well. Or entertain any other ideas for defraying the cost so we can make this available as, you know, an expansion of how we open and keep lines of communication and dialogue open. So how would you all like us to proceed?
I'm assuming that other human rights commissions are like us and have no funds.
I assume that is correct.
I would think the first way we'd approach is certainly our own city council. I have a whole lot of hope for it, but I think that's where we should start.
And would we want to ask them to be co-sponsors of the training trainers?
Well, does that mean they would fund it? I mean, it would be part of it. It would be incorporated into the budget, or
wouldn't be in the budget for this year. But I don't know if they would like to make.
So I think we would need to make a proposal before we could go to them, because we'd have to say, who do we think is going to take this training? What's going to happen? We can say why we want it. That's why we're even making the proposal. But I would ask, so who do you think is going to be there? What are they going to do after they do this? Is there a plan for how this will roll out further before anyone seeds the money to do this? And I don't have a good sense of that.
In one meeting in the past, we did talk about trying to get to invite people from every ward to become trainers so that we could have someone trained in every part of the city. To get to ask the Youth Commission if they would like to have a couple of people trained so that we can go out to the schools if they'd like to take advantage of that. Why, I think the why we're trying to do this and now, I think we can.
That's straightforward.
Yeah. But moving out beyond the training of trainers, we could, the folks, was it you and Lori that were at the training?
I wasn't.
You weren't, no, it must have been Christine.
It was, yeah.
Yeah, so Christine and Lori can give some testimony about what it was like to be at the training. And the impact it had on folks in that room, and how we want to spread that throughout the community. And who do we think will take it? I think we would want to find that's a good question. I think we'd want to find a cross-section of this city representing different demographics, different age, gender, orientations, racial, ethnic, religious backgrounds. But will it be self-selected, or will we ask people to nominate? I don't know.
Housing development,
yes,
or a person from this senior center, that is a potential.
I think it's actually, if we have, we're able to, even better to have two from each place, because then they can support each other. Mm-hmm. I think a train the trainers works well.
Teams of trainers.
Yeah,
team training. But then we'd have, you know, then I guess we would need to know it. I don't know if we need to know it in advance. I was involved with train the trainer for teaching folk. How to teach healthcare providers how to talk about end of life care. And then how to take care of geriatric patients. So you had to say, okay, you're going back to this place, and you, the two of you are going to train these nine people. They were nine people who were going to go into these other places. So it would be nice if we could do that. Though it was also open to people who just wanted to learn how to do it for themselves. But I'm used to somebody who I'm asking for money to do this, to say, tell me that million, tell me what you think is.
Yeah. I think the way I understand it is that the trainers would be like the trainers that did the workshop at JFK. They would just train folks who would want to be bystanders, who want to be more active bystanders, but not necessarily train more trainers. So they would train active bystanders. But I think they would have to go through the training of trainers to be officially
trained. Okay. So they're more peer teachers.
Yes. So they'd be able to facilitate the active bystander workshop.
Forget what I said.
Well, no, it's in an ideal world, it would be great. Maybe there's grants for places.
Last year, I remember she mentioned some type of grant or something. I can't remember now what it was for, but I can look back in the emails and see if that's applicable. That was one long ago.
It was like, a seed fund.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Okay. All right, so I think what I'll do then is, there's no urgency of, we're not going to start this during the summer, so I think I'll just put a proposal together and bring it to the next meeting in July.
I want to say how much I appreciate how much you take on. We decide on things to do.
I think that brings us to the end of our meeting as well. We will be losing a quorum when we start. And I think we've pretty much come to the end of our agenda, except for new business, which any
you're urgent. Already trying to bring. So shall an agenda item for the next meeting be thinking about what do we want to focus on in the future? I mean, you raised a really, really, really good point.
Yeah, are we gonna respond to our meeting, the letters that we got?
Yes, so I'll put some discernment on the next agenda.
I don't know if you guys got yours from Lori, the Armenian. Armenian Americans for Human Rights. They had sent a letter for all to each individual person in the Human Rights Commission and asked us to read through it. So I think Lori has a hold of your copies.
It's a letter about. It was a problem with the Anti-Defamation League because the language they had about the Armenian.
Did she send it to his email?
No, they mailed it to all of us.
It's piece of paper.
Yeah.
It's real paper.
Motion to adjourn?
Move. Second.
All in favor? Okay.